Its nickname is the Free State of Livingston Parish, and it is located in southeast Louisiana between Baton Rouge and New Orleans. Known as one of the state's Florida parishes, Livingston was named in honor of Edward Livingston, a Secretary of State to President Andrew Jackson. Irregular in shape, the parish is 32 miles long from north to south and 30 miles from east to west. 400 miles of waterways run throughout Livingston, while Interstate 12 cuts through its heart, separating the parish's two distinct landscapes. The north of the parish is characterized by a rolling terrain covered by slash pine and hardwood forests, while the south is populated by rich cypress forests bordering the marshes of Lake Maurepas and the Amite River. Today, over 145,000 people call Livingston their home, which makes it one of the fastest growing parishes in the state of Louisiana.
If you want to go down to the river, spend time on the river, or you want to go to a big city, it's all right here. You have it all. So it's a great place to live. Education system is awesome. It's a more of a bedroom community. So we're not overpopulated, although we are growing tremendously because of our location, because of the great things we have to offer, the quality of life. Now, since Bass Pro came in, it has really put a focus on us for business. So you see a lot of business growth. With Bass Pro comes restaurants, hotels, Jubin Crossing, a big shopping development we have here. So all them things coming together, it makes Livingston a great place to live. You have everything you want here. You don't have to travel somewhere else to get it.
The other side of that coin is the affordable housing. Our housing is usually less expensive than other parishes. You can purchase, a $250,000 home in Livingston Parish, and you could have, a half acre of land, whereas in other parishes, you can't get that and have a safe neighborhood and have a good school system. And then we've actually recruited industry that has brought 1,000 direct jobs, and most of those have what we call a multiplier effect. So you could look at potentially an additional 3,000 jobs outside of the property boundaries of that facility.
So all of the amenities that people want in their upscale places to live, you're going to have them in Livingston Parish. So of course, a very high caliber of person is going to be attracted to Livingston. The good schools, all the amenities, the availability of land, the future is very bright.
However, before it was called Livingston, the parish itself was a vastly different place.
One of the things that's really interesting about Livingston Parish and that people often forget is that there was history before the arrival of the Europeans. And Livingston Parish, situated as it was along the rivers there and with so many little small tributaries flowing down to them and everything, had significant groups of Native Americans living there. And of course, they didn't record history, they didn't write it, so we don't have as much in terms of records on them as we do on later groups. But they were very vibrant. In the early periods, they were known as the Petite Nations. It included groups like the Bayou Gula, the Homa, the Tunica, others like that. They were later displaced by Choctaw and other larger tribes like that. All across Livingston Parish today, you can find reminders that Native Americans were present in significant numbers. If you look at the shell middens along the riverways, like along the Amite and Tickfaw and the Taubini Rivers, that's where a vibrant culture was living, and essentially it was their trash dump. And many people that are long-term residents of Livingston Parish can remember when there used to be Indian mounds all over the place. There are a few remaining right now, but there was a large number. And in fact, the first European who came to the area, Iberville, and of course he's coming right through, he's coming from the Mississippi River through Bayou Manchac. He hits the Amite River right there near where Port Vincent would be today. Travels on out to Lake Maurepas, he described it as one of the prettiest spots I have ever seen in his journal when he talked about being the first European to look at what we now know as Livingston Parish.
Livingston Parish is in the heart of a region north of Lakes Maurepas and Pontchartrain that we call the Florida Parishes. And the name comes from the fact that the Spanish settled Florida, and it was the French who settled at the mouth of the river. And so for many of the early colonial years, the Spanish were over in Florida and the French were here in the lower Mississippi River Valley.
And then after that, development began rather slowly. You know, in the French period, a few settlers settled in around French settlement and other areas. Some Isleños came in later around Galvez and spread into the areas around Port Vincent like that. But there wasn't in Livingston Parish the really rich quality soil that you found along the Mississippi Delta.
With it being a timbered parish, it was not a alluvial parish like along the Mississippi River. If anyone's ever tried to dig up a pine stump, very difficult because it has a large taproot, and of course the soil is acidic.
For example, in East Baton Rouge Parish and the Feliciana Parishes, they had soil that was very conducive to the arrival of the cotton economy, and you didn't see that spread into Livingston at first. So Livingston did not develop a large slave-based economy like the Felicianas and some of the regions further to the north in the Florida Parishes did and up into Mississippi.
Eventually, the French and the Indians were at war with England, and Spain allied herself with France, and then the British won the war.
The French and Indian War began in 1754 and was the North American conflict in a larger imperial war between Great Britain and France, which is now known as the Seven Years' War. The war concluded with the Treaty of Paris in 1963. The war provided Great Britain enormous territorial gains in North America.
So Britain had a series of colonies on the eastern seaboard, and they wanted to connect all the way down through Florida with their colonies in the Caribbean. And so they chose to, in the peace conference that ended the war, the English took the Spanish Florida. So those all those settlements that had been made by the Spanish had to take down the Spanish flag and raise the British flag. And so that meant that this area between the Mississippi River and the Pearl River were going to be under British rule. And that continued until the American Revolution. And in the course of the American Revolution, the Spanish sided with the revolting American colonies. And when they did so, that meant that at the peace conference in Paris that ended the American Revolution, the Spanish were able to say to the British, "We want the Floridas back."
When the Spanish came in, they encouraged migration into the area. In fact, they had a very open door policy. And in parishes like Livingston, a lot of the older families can trace their landholdings all the way back to Spanish land grants, because the Spanish were eager to populate the area with people who were not friendly to the Americans, because they wanted it as a buffer to their more lucrative holdings to the west in Texas and down in Mexico to keep the Americans back. So they gave generous land grants, typically of 640 acres. They didn't mess with you at all. There was no police force to harass you or anything like that. You didn't even have to pay taxes on that land. So it was very popular with people.
At that point, the Americans began flooding south and west. People moved from the older settled colonies of Georgia and the Carolinas and Virginia and came south and west. And there was an abundance of land.
Yet another thing in that same period that was emerging that was attracting people to Livingston and stimulating growth and economic development was the fact that the Natchez Trace, its terminus there at Natchez, unless you had the resources to build a flatboat or to navigate the river, the way you got your goods to market was you followed a series of trails, many of which left Natchez and came across what is now Livingston Parish, going either to Springfield, Port Vincent. There was even for a time a small port at French Settlement, and those became major hubs for transporting commodities, everything. It could be timber, it could be what they called naval stores, which were tar, pitch, turpentine, resin, which was gathered from burning down pine trees and stuff, to things like, I've read letters describing herds of turkeys being taken by, you know, with people with sticks guiding the herds of turkeys, and they'd flush them up into the trees at night, and then in the morning use sticks and knock them all back down and everything, you know, and herd them on, put them on some type of steamer or other schooner going across the lake, leaving Port Vincent, Springfield, any one of those spots. So communities began to develop in all those areas as well.
Because of the location of Springfield and Madisonville, people that came down from the Midwest, they had to walk back if they couldn't afford to buy a passage. Of course, you know the Mississippi River is an old meandering river. By coming across the lakes to either Madisonville or Springfield and going up what we call the Turnpike, the Albany Springfield Road, it cut 3 days off their travels getting back to Natchez. While this area was not part of the Natchez Trace, it was a contributing trail to the Natchez Trace. Most people assume that all of Louisiana was acquired by the Louisiana Purchase in 1803, but the Spanish still held West Florida, which was the area that we're in. The Spanish had permitted Anglo settlers to acquire what's called head rights because they wanted to populate their, you know, territory. And as long as the family would pledge allegiance, you know, to the Spanish king, they were permitted to gain a head right.
Those Americans who came here oftentimes were fleeing justice in the oldest settled regions. And if they came here, they were under Spanish law, not American law, and so they didn't really have to worry. But as this area began to be settled by English-speaking settlers, they became unhappy with Spanish rule.
Then something dramatic happened, and that was a group of people decided they didn't want to be under Spanish authority anymore. And so they began organizing what would climax with what is known as the West Florida Revolt. And that was largely a movement that began in the Feliciana, specifically around the St. Francisville and Bayou Sara area. But what people don't realize as much, there was a heavy involvement in Livingston Parish. And Livingston may have been at the forefront of the really civil war within that war that went on, because Livingston was evenly divided. You had three groups in the West Florida Revolt. One we call the Americanists, and these were people that were upset that the Florida parishes had been left out of the Louisiana Purchase. A second group, and probably the largest of them, were the pro-Spanish group, and those are the people who were happy with the land grants they'd gotten, who did not want those land grants to be threatened by some other power coming in and negating them and giving out new grants. And so they were fiercely supportive of the Spanish. The third group may best be described as the independents. And these were people, I always joke that these were your precursors to real estate agents. They said, hey, if we create a new independent nation here, all this property is going to be up for taking again. You know, we can get to give out these new land grants. It's going to be an economic boom land speculation.
And there was a fort, a Spanish fort in Baton Rouge. And that Spanish fort was assaulted by a military force drawn up by men from the Pearl River over to the Mississippi, and they marched on Baton Rouge.
What happened was, when the revolt broke out, some of them came down from Pinckneyville, Mississippi, and there they combined with a group from St. Francisville, Bayou Sara, there in West Feliciana Parish. And they had sent calls out, and they were having what was called a convention. And representatives from each of the parishes were coming, Livingston Parish included. And so what happened, the spark that set it all, the governor, De La Suze, had been feigning cooperation with them. And of course, they were gradually usurping his authority. And he didn't have enough troops at his disposal to put down the revolt, a dilapidated fort there in Baton Rouge. He's got about 28 soldiers there. It's not enough. So he was in a compromised position. He had to kind of fiend working with them. But he, in desperation, when he saw the convention was moving towards total eclipse of Spanish authority in the area, he sent a desperate message to Vicente Folk, who was the governor general at Pensacola, who did have resources enough to put down the revolt. And that messenger was intercepted by a rebel patrol, a patrol loyal to the convention. And when they got the letter and they saw his duplicity, that he was actually calling for aid from Pensacola, they agreed we got to go and go now. So Philemon Thomas sent out the call. You know, the groups came down from West Feliciana. A group of 44 men literally ran from Springfield in Livingston Parish to the rendezvous point. They waited for many hours there before sunrise for the St. Helena contingent to arrive. They were delayed and did not get there in time, though. And right before dawn, one of the old country boys said, "I know a way we can get in there without them being able to use their artillery," because the artillery was one thing that the Spanish had that gave them an advantage.
But the Spanish drank milk, so they milked cows every day. And if you know anything about cows, they go out and graze during the day. They usually milked in the morning, and then they come back in the evening. And if you drive through dairy sections, you'll see cows moving in the morning and in the evening. They just cut a hole, in effect, through the wall of the fort so the cows could come and go. And some of the attackers knew about that cow. I call it a cow gate, but that like a cat door in a house where cats can go in and out. They had that sort of thing for the cows. It was big enough for a cow to go through. It was big enough for a man to go through. So they went through in the early hours of the morning.
There was a sharp little firefight there where several men on the Spanish side were killed. And then they raised the original Lone Star flag and proclaimed the original Lone Star Republic right there on that day, September 10, 1810.
They went on up the river to St. Francisville. And they created what they called a legislative assembly, and they adopted a declaration proclaiming the West Florida Republic, and they elected a leader whose name was Fulwar Skipwith. Can't get much more English than Fulwar Skipwith.
The first thing they did was dispatch an army under General Philemon Thomas. He marches out of the fort of Baton Rouge with 450 men, and he's headed for Livingston Parish, specifically for Springfield, where a man named William Cooper has organized a pro-Spanish militia too, and they've actually built a fort near present-day Springfield along the Natalbany River. And there, when the rebel army got there, they had him so outnumbered, most of them fled. But Cooper and some others were captured. They burned their farms, killed all their livestock. And Cooper, somehow in the process, was allegedly killed. The story was, while he was trying to escape, some said they simply executed him. To set an example for other people who wanted to remain loyal to Spain. Yet another story says they gave him one of those things in the next 30 seconds, you know, if you're not out of here, your brains will be all over the ground. And they let him escape to Pensacola, where he lived a quiet life, never messing with anybody. Regardless, they were successful. The rebels, as they moved across, they pacified the entire region and proclaimed the Republic of West Florida. And it extended from the Pearl River to the Mississippi River, with Livingston right at its epicenter. Center there, and it became one of the first independent republics in America. What was most significant about it was it arguably was the impetus for hemispheric freedom from Spanish colonialism, because once that revolt was successful, men from this area, from Livingston Parish and the other surrounding parishes, went west to Texas and helped participate and foment revolt there, which was successful. It then tracked out to California, where they had the Bear Flag Revolt there, and then proceeded down into South America. And it all began right here in the Florida parishes, with Livingston Parish playing a big role in it.
I used to tell students in my Louisiana history classes that if you run across an obstreperous Texan, you can always bring them to their knees when you tell them that we had a Lone Star flag here in 1810, long before the Battle of the Alamo or anybody had thought of Texas.
This is the only region, the Florida parishes, that we have identified in the United States where every major European power that intruded into the North American wilderness had governmental authority at some point. So first you had the French, then you had the British, then you had the Spanish, then you had the West Florida Revolt, and then you had the Americans.
But from what I've read, almost from the beginning, the men of the West Florida Republic were sub rosa negotiating with the United States for annexation. And when President Monroe got the word that they were interested in being annexed, he said, as far as he was concerned, It was all part of the Louisiana Purchase and ordered Claiborne to go up there and occupy the region. And there was never any court proceeding or anything to contest the military occupation. It was that old business of, you know, a bird in the hand. We were in the hand of the United States military, and we didn't have enough military to contest it, even if we wanted to. So the West Florida Republic only lasted for 70-some-odd days.
After that, the Americans arrived, and through force of arms, because they brought in an army and they brought a naval flotilla in the Mississippi River and forcibly annexed the territory. And then Livingston became a part of the United States. And that's where, as I said, the introduction of the cotton economy and everything made it more normal with what you were seeing in the Gulf South region. And this was a different type of cotton that arrived, first arrived in this area around the 1820s. And it could grow in pine uplands regions. Typically, cotton production needed heavy hardwoods that left the loess covering on the soil that made the soil rich and everything. And Livingston Parish, of course, had more cypress and pine trees and stuff, depending on where you were. But when the Siamese black seed variety was introduced, it could grow in pine uplands as well. So the cotton economy did arrive in Livingston Parish, and that was the first real stimulus to development in the area. But it always had this peculiar distinction of being part of this convoluted area, because when the multiple different governing powers were there, in addition to many of these respectable people who were coming in for the land grants and everything, it was also a haven for desperados, for army deserters from four different armies and stuff who were concentrating in the area. So there were always problems of instability.
Well, I think the frontier in American history was always the location of people of, shall we say, modest reverence for the law. If you were outside of the law, you got outside of the law, and that was the frontier.
As the region headed towards the Civil War, there was also a demand for a greater voice in government. Livingston Parish had some very notable figures emerge who played key roles in Louisiana government and in congressmen as well. Thomas Green Davidson is a name that comes to mind very quickly and everything. He was very much one of the most powerful men in the Louisiana legislature. And he helped put Livingston on the map in terms of being a political force in the new state as it was emerging. All of that was good and fine. You know, they went through the Constitution of 1845, which expanded the vote to people in the area. Then opportunity was rolled back with the Constitution of 1852, which made a lot of people in the Livingston area unhappy. And as we got on the eve of the Civil War, there was a lot of dissent and friction politically in the area, which was mitigated by the fact that the Yankees were coming, okay? And, you know, we could have a slave revolt, all these things that we need to stick together. And then the war breaks out.
During the Civil War, 14 engagements were fought in Livingston Parish. 8 battles were fought in the vicinity of the Amite River, 1 at Benton's Ferry, 2 at French Settlement, 2 in the Springfield area, and 1 on the Tickfall River.
And one of the things, you know, the initial enthusiasm, like much of the rest of the South, this region, fully 82% of its manpower willingly went into the Confederate Army and served, you know, in many cases with distinction and everything. But in Livingston Parish, one of the things a lot of people celebrate is the fact that there were a few that did not serve and that held out and opposed the Confederacy. Now, whether those were noble, you know, union-loving people that a lot of people like to paint them as, are more likely people that realized when a war breaks out, bad things happen. The army comes in requisitioning our stuff, they need our corn, they need our mules, etc. You know, and the Confederates were taking that. They were also pressing men into service in the Confederate Army. A lot of people, they called them druthers because they'd druther not serve. Well, as the war started going worse for the Confederacy, those guys, the government was saying, druther or not, you know, we need you out in the army, you know, with a musket in your hand, get out there and everything. And a few like Adolph Diaz, you know, dug in and said, you know, no, we're not going to serve, you know, and they killed some Confederate conscription agents at Springfield famously. Carruthers sharpshooters were sent after them in a dramatic event, and they had a big shootout not far from French Settlement and everything where they killed several of them. And that gives rise to this myth of the free state of Livingston. But how noble that effort was. Like I said, there's a lot of evidence to suggest that they may not want to raise that flag too high, because most evidence suggests there was a lot of horse thievery going on and stealing of government horses and stuff and everything that may be, just as it was with Newton Knight and his group up in Mississippi, who the recent movie was done, which a lot of it was shot in the Florida parishes. But the war was hard on the region, and it was simply devastating to the South. And what a lot of people forget is, unlike Europe after World War II, there was no Marshall Plan for the defeated South. And in fact, it was just the opposite. The radicals seized control of Congress, and they were intent on punishing the South. So they came up with something called the state suicide theory, which essentially said that, although we said the whole time during the war, you cannot secede, now we're saying you actually did secede, and that means that you are now conquered provinces, and we can treat you however we wish to treat you. So Livingston Parish got caught up in that. And basically what you're dealing with is people desperate to get the scraps from a very meager table. And many families began to sell their property off at dirt cheap prices, et cetera. Companies came in from the north and other regions, and a lot of this was prime timberland. And immediately after the Civil War, there was a boom in railroad construction. And Jay Gould, the great railroad promoter, in fact, the New York financier, and he had interests in Chicago and Philadelphia, all over and everything, he actually became the largest landowner in Louisiana, because he was buying up so much. And again, the people were desperately poor, trying to sell anything they had just to survive. And a lot of this land was selling for as little as $1.25 an acre. And he was buying it up with the intention of putting railroads wherever he could. And so as these lands, and they get, you know, the state to go along with it, because of course commerce like that is good for the state, the railroads began to spring up everywhere. And that's when you saw the east-west line come through.
I think it was Breckenridge Lumber and Railroad Navigation Company. They would haul, had a mill up just about where I-12 would cross Highway 43, and the logs would be, timber would be cut and milled up there and loaded up and hauled to Springfield, put on ships to go to New Orleans. That was around the turn of the century. That mill was what brought a lot of the Hungarians over here.
And they began cutting, whole scale, cutting the timber off, cutting the cypress forest off in the lowland regions, cutting the pine forest off in the upland regions. There was no thought given to reforestation. So in a matter of years, as we went through the 1870s, you know, those very hard reconstruction years into the 1880s and into the 1890s, much of the region was utterly denuded of its very valuable timber products, you know, that had been a sustaining portion of the economy for so long.
In 1915, the Lyon Cypress Lumber Company ran out of cypress in their territory south here, so they built a railroad on up Highway 63 that runs south out of Livingston. It's built on their old right-of-way. And they came in and cut pine up on this end until probably mid-1920s. They cut out of the pine they had, and they pulled a track up.
And that's what contributed to the really hard times in Livingston Parish and the surrounding parishes. And by that, I mean times where feud, factions, bitter family struggles, the region descended to the brink of utter chaos. The legal system was completely compromised. Livingston had some particular problems with that, because during Reconstruction, the parish divided into an East faction and a West faction. One group was wanting to keep the courthouse at Springfield, the other group wanted it moved to Port Vincent, and it was very, very bitter politics that now that you've got economic stagnation and downright economic malaise, you've got corruption in state government, you've got federal government, which is doing everything they can to make your life harder, because they're saying those rebels deserve exactly what they're getting. The people turned on themselves, and a bloodbath ensued. And Livingston, Tanchbehoe, Washington parishes sustained the highest rural homicide rates recorded in American history, as legal authority simply collapsed. The court system was compromised by the variety of factions. The district attorney was accused of being openly partisan to one group. Some of the judges were accused of the same type of thing. No one could get justice, and a crisis of confidence occurred. Massive family feuds such as the Lanier-Kirby feud, which the papers refer to as the Tanner-Kirby feud, were not just people killing people and taking the law into their own hands. It was burning houses, murdering children, in one case even burning a man alive. So it was as vicious as it could get. And Livingston and its surrounding parishes went through this very, very dark period.
We had Sheriff Willie Graves talk to our historical society, and he pointed out that when his dad was sheriff, they only had, you know, 10 or 12 deputies covering the whole of, you know, Livingston Parish.
But it has changed. As the region came into the 20th century, a more assertive government authority was established, which helped the region continue to struggle with economic malaise coming into the first decades of the 20th century. But they made it through. And this was the time where you found the small family farms, you found people relying on fisheries, you found people engaged in steamer services from Port Vincent and Springfield and other places like that. And Livingston Parish continued on through the hard times of the Depression and everything. And it wasn't until after World War II that a real impetus to development began. And Livingston Parish began to see, as you began to see, flight out of the urban centers, and particularly out of Baton Rouge, and people beginning to relocate in Livingston Parish. The same thing for people coming across the lake from New Orleans and beginning to locate initially in St. Tammany, then some in Tangipahoa, and then spreading over into Livingston Parish. You began to see a real dichotomy in development in Livingston Parish. Specifically, there was always a tendency, and the joke always is you could draw the line right along I-12. And if you were north of I-12 in Livingston Parish, there was one type of culture. If you're south of I-12, there's another type of culture. That northern culture being more your Anglo Protestant, very Baptist and fundamentalist Protestant, whereas south of you find more Catholics, you find more people of Latin descent, meaning of French or Isleño or other Spanish type descents and everything. And that's often reflected, we used to joke, in being able to buy a beer on Sunday. The joke always was, you know, that if you got off the interstate north of I-12 on Sunday, you couldn't buy beer anywhere in Livingston Parish. But if you got off south, you could not only buy beer, but you could go in a bar and get a mixed drink, even on a Sunday, you know, and it showed a difference in the way those types of people think about things. But there was also a big east-west split between the parish as increasing and now torrential movement of people out of Baton Rouge into Livingston Parish. They brought a different type of culture with them. And on the eastern portion of the parish, it remained more traditional. So what you saw around Albany was maybe more the way Livingston Parish had looked, you know, in its more traditional form, whereas what you saw in Denham Springs was the suburban sprawl coming out of Baton Rouge and completely transforming the area there. And when you look today, whereas you used to see more of a north-south split in voting patterns and things like that in Livingston Parish, you now see more of an east-west split. Now, all of these problems and challenges that we've discussed that occurred in Livingston Parish, there's a real silver lining in it, and that is what's going on today. Because today, if you look at Livingston Parish, it's one of the fastest growing in the state. Its school system is one of the most highly regarded in the state. You know, people clamor to get their kids into schools in Livingston Parish. A job teaching in Livingston Parish is regarded as a plum job today. The infrastructure, parish government is up and functioning. It is a new world.
Well, I think if you look at Livingston Parish today and see where we were years and years ago, post-Katrina, the growth that the parish has experienced, the amount of people that have moved into our parish. We're going to double in population over the next few years, and because of that, you've seen a Jubin Crossing Mall come. We have a Bass Pro, and of course, LIGO, which is nationally known, Nobel Prize winning situation there.
We have a Nobel Prize winner right here in Livingston Parish that most people don't have a clue about. There's only two in the United States, which is called LIGO. The one that we have here in Livingston is located just north of Livingston, the town of Livingston. But they won a Nobel Prize for their discovery of gravitational waves. It's a national program to locate Livingston and say, hey, we want to go there and do this and do these studies. You know, that shows we do have things to offer here.
For many, many years now, on different occasions where I've spoke, that our primary draw is the people of Livingston Parish. Warm, friendly, religious, good people, willing to help their neighbors, willing to meet people, welcoming new people into the parish, which I'm not saying other parishes don't do that, but I think they're exceptionally good at that here in Livingston Parish. We've never lost that sense of family. We'll have our squabbles politically. We'll have our differences on different things that come up like everyone does. But you let somebody else come in, or you let some tragedy hit, or you let a flood come or something like that, and you see Livingston Parish people just unite. They don't wait on outside help. They unite, they work as a family, they welcome people into their homes. And I jokingly said, just really to kind of make a little light moment, but after the flood of 2016, I said, you know, we saw people that didn't even like one another bring people into their homes and welcome them in and become the best of friends, and they'll never forget now how close they are. They'll always be close. And I was half joking about that, but the truth is, that is what we are in Livingston Parish. We come together when we need to.
This parish and the communities within it have brought themselves back up out of that terrible incident. And we have rebuilt not only our homes, but our neighborhoods. We've rebuilt our cities, and we've rebuilt our parish. And I only see great things coming.
We were looking back when it was roughly 129 to 130, we were looking, according to LSU, to double over the next 12 to 13, 14 years. We thought maybe the flood would slow that down. I'm not sure it's going to slow it down at all, because we're still seeing a phenomenal amount of work in our planning and permitting departments from people wanting to look at doing subdivisions and things like that. So I think we're going to continue. I think we're on that path still.